you for joining us today. We trust that you will be motivated, challenged, and inspired by this week's message. Let's join Mike now.
All right, well, today it's Palm Sunday. I guess you knew that. Palm Sunday is focusing on Christ's entry into Jerusalem. If you wonder why I'm filling in with my cross, it's because earlier it came out and they said I look like the Pope, so I'm trying to make sure it's in. Although looking like the Pope might not be a bad thing right now, or even the Archbishop of Canterbury, because they're two very good guys that are getting very good press, saying really good things, and I think there's some final hope for the traditional church to come out and really start spreading some good news. So we're pleased for the Pope and we're pleased for the Archbishop. They're good guys, just know that. So Palm Sunday, just if my cross comes out, Sean will let me know. Yeah, just do that and I'll know. Okay, all right. Palm Sunday is focusing on Christ's entry into Jerusalem. I want you to imagine the scene for a moment, because this was a time of great celebration, jubilation, praise. It would have been noisy. You know, for people who find churches too noisy, well, you should have been around in Jesus' time, because I reckon it would have been deafening. You know what it's like when that atmosphere starts to be created in a football stadium, when there's lots of people together, and you know the atmosphere starts to build, and then the Mexican wave takes place, and you know there was lots of Mexican waves on Palm Sunday. It would have been an amazing atmosphere as people were singing and shouting. Listen to this in Matthew 21 verse 6. Nearly all the people in the crowd threw their garments down on the road, giving him a royal welcome. Now, just in case you were wondering, yes, some of those garments would have been worth a lot of money. Some of those would have been our Versace and Armani garments, because there would have been people in that crowd, all sorts of people, mixture of people, but there would have been those that would have put their garments down without question for Jesus to ride over. Others cut branches from the trees and threw them down as a welcome mat. Crowds went ahead and crowds followed, all of them calling out, "Hosanna to David's son. Blessed is he who comes in God's name. Hosanna in highest heaven." As he made his entrance into Jerusalem, the whole city was shaken. How do you know when you're having an impact? When the whole city is shaken because you're there. Unnerved, people were asking, what's going on here? Who is this? The parade crowd answered, this is the prophet Jesus, the one from Nazareth in Galilee. I think it goes without saying that this was the entrance of all entrances. This event, like so many of the events that are recorded in Scripture, are not just hugely historical, but very significant. When we talk about these events, we're not talking about Palm Sunday being an historic event. We're talking about something that's very, very significant to us today. And I'm going to try and bring out as much as I can throughout the course of this message. So it's called Palm Sunday. And I guess you know why that was, because people were waving palms as Jesus rode into Jerusalem. But you know, the palm branch was something much more significant than someone just kind of looking around going, well, let me just pick that branch off that tree. You know, it wasn't done just because that was the nearest tree, that was the nearest branch, that was the only thing that they could break off. There was huge significance because it was a symbol of triumph and victory in Jewish tradition. And so what people were doing was showing immense honor as they waved their palms, as they put them on the ground and made a carpet for his path along with their garments. Huge, huge, immense honor. This was the ultimate red carpet experience. Unlike celebrities, though, that have walked on the red carpet, Jesus didn't have a limousine. He didn't even choose a horse. He rode in on a donkey. Why a donkey? What's the significance of the donkey? So we got the significance of the palm. What's the significance of the donkey? Everything that Jesus did had significance. Well, firstly, Zechariah 9 and verse 9. Zechariah prophesied it by saying, "Rejoice, O people of Zion. Shout in triumph, O people of Jerusalem. Look, your king is coming to you. He is righteous and victorious, yet he is humble, riding on a donkey, riding on a donkey's colt." So yes, this was fulfilling prophecy. We would naturally think that transport fit for a king or a queen, even nowadays, would be a horse. Our own royal family, still for royal celebrations, will often use horse and carriage, right? But it was tradition for a conquering leader to ride into a defeated city on a horse. However, a returning monarch always entered his recaptured and rescued city on a donkey. So huge significance, not because they just couldn't find a horse, but because Jesus chose. Remember, he said, "Go to these people and ask them to give you a donkey so that I might ride." So it was purposeful. It was done on purpose. If Jesus had rode in on a horse, his message would have been one of war, not peace. Riding a donkey proved that he was the king of peace. People recognized Jesus as a king. He was proven that he was not only victorious and righteous, but also humble. That was the significance of the donkey, that he was humble. He had a servant heart. It was a very dramatic act. It was a very public demonstration of his humility. Jesus' opposition had already let it be very known that they were intending to kill him. So you would understand if Jesus had chosen to maybe come in and do the whole Palm Sunday thing at night, when he wouldn't draw the attention that he was inevitably going to draw by making this entrance of all entrances. Every eye was firmly fixed on Jesus. Jesus knew full well that the reaction that his entrance would cause a stir. And for me, it speaks of real courage in the face of real danger. We're all going to experience real danger in our lives. And we prove how strong our courage really is when we're faced with danger. He was about to face the greatest challenge of his life. He was under no illusion. He made this entrance into this most significant week of his life, knowing full well what was going to happen. He knew exactly what was going to happen. Come on, he was Jesus. He knows things ahead of time, whereas we're guessing. He knew what was going to come up. He knew what the week really was going to, and how the week was going to unfold. And he was about to face the greatest challenge of his life, a horrific crucifixion. And yet in the process, he would also experience the greatest triumph, a miraculous resurrection. Aren't you glad that the story goes on? It doesn't end, but it goes on to the resurrection. It's almost like the story ended and restarted again. Everybody thought it was over on Good Friday, but praise God, it started again on Sunday. And the story is still being written. That's what I want to bring out as our theme today. When there's a challenge on your hands, there's a champion in your heart. He was determined to make this last week that he would spend on earth the most significant week of his life. I wonder how you and I would live our last week if we knew it was going to be our last week. Jesus knew this was going to be his last week. And he put everything into that week. In just 1 week, he went from a cheering crowd to a jeering crowd. Most of those who celebrated his entrance would a few days later be celebrating his departure. Crowds are fickle, so we can never trust applause. It only took 5 days for Hosanna to become Crucify. Speak to any pastor, and they will tell you they know that feeling. Jesus knew his purpose. He went into this week saying this in John 18:37. You say rightly that I am a king. For this cause I was born, and for this cause I have come into the world, that I should bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth hears my voice. You see, Jesus was able to face this week because he knew who he was and why he was here. I want us just to pause for a second and ask ourselves that question. Do we know who we are? And do we know why we're here? And not just that we are believers, but do we know our purpose as a believer? Do we know why we are here? Why we exist? Why we are right now living and breathing on planet Earth? Because I know my purpose. That's why I can come to church today and we can have a smaller crowd of people, and it doesn't, of course, the natural wants to try and affect me. The devil wants to try and use that to affect me. But ultimately, it doesn't affect me because I know why I'm here. I know what I'm called to do. And whether there's one person in the congregation or no people in the congregation, hey, listen, I would still be preaching right now just for God. God doesn't need my preaching, but I need to preach for God. I know that this message will go way beyond the four walls of this church today, and we need to celebrate that, and that's something God has graced our church with. So I know my purpose, and therefore it will drive me to do what I need to do, even in the face of the most challenging times. And you will not maybe understand how much a challenge it is for someone who speaks when there isn't a big crowd to speak to. I want to tell you the most difficult crowds to speak to are the small crowds. When I go and I preach to thousands of people in the States, it's never an issue. I don't feel nervous because the crowd just brings a different atmosphere. When people gather together, that's what naturally happens. But you often don't get that atmosphere when you have a smaller group of people. So it's much, much harder. Some of you do presentations. Some of you know what I'm talking about, because in that little room, when you're doing a presentation and all eyes are on you and you can pretty much see everybody's face, it's much harder than just seeing a sea of faces. So your challenges won't be my challenges, and my challenges won't be your challenges, but we are all dealing with things that we're faced with as challenges. But we get through those challenges because we know who we are and why we're here. When you know who you are and whose you are and why you're here, it makes all the difference to how you face, what you face, when you face it along the way. Jesus' love was so strong for us that not even death would stop him or prevent him from going through this horrific ordeal and embracing the cross just for you. I think the biggest lesson we could learn from this story is that we don't need to shrink from our challenges. When challenges come our way, we need to remember our greatest challenge has the potential to result in our greatest victory. When there's a challenge on your hands, you will always find a champion in your heart. No challenge, no champion. Without a challenge coming in, the champion won't come out. So we are not doing ourselves any favors if we try and live a life without challenge. In fact, God has a unique way when we try and run from challenge to bring a few more our way. And the reason he does that is not to give us a life that's full of pain and discomfort and unpleasant, but God knows that we need challenge. I'm going to help you understand why we need it today and why it's right that we should be challenged, why we should face different trials and tests in life. We don't need to ever be afraid of anything that ever comes our way, because whoever is against us and whatever happens to us is nothing compared to who is fighting for us. Darlene's written another great song on that album. We'll be doing it here at some point. And the chorus is exactly that, or the middle eight, one of the sections is, God is fighting for us. We forget that. God is always fighting for us. Therefore, whatever is against us has to bow the knee. We can face the most difficult circumstances and the most challenging scenarios with a real sense of hope. That's what makes the difference between you and someone who doesn't have your faith. Now, anybody can have this faith because it's not exclusive, it's inclusive. God wants everybody to have our faith. God wants everybody to believe in him so that we can stare our challenges in the face and say, at the name of Jesus, you need to bow. I would be pretty scared to be living my life right now without faith. But with a faith, I can face an uncertain world and a hopeless world with a sense of hope. See, when we can face those scenarios because we've got the hope of God inside of us, however difficult it might be, and I'm not saying it's always easy. I'm not trying to make it easy today. I'm just saying that we can do it. Not everything in life is easy. We say it to our kids. Come on, you have to try. Have a go. You know, if you don't try, you won't know. It's interesting, isn't it, that we teach our kids that and then we don't adopt that in later life. We kind of preach it to our kids, but then we don't live it out in life. And we've got to face those challenges head on. But it's amazing when we've got that real sense of hope that we start to gain a real true perspective of what James was saying in James 1 and verse 2. This won't be your favorite scripture, I can guarantee you. If it is, I need to talk to you. Where he said, consider it a sheer gift, friends, when tests and challenges come at you from all sides. I bet you do not have that underlined in your Bible, apart from if it's just to remind you. You know, it might be a reminder underline, but it's not one of your favorite, you know, fridge magnet, toilet door scriptures. You know that under pressure, your faith life is forced into the open and shows its true colors. So don't try to get out of anything prematurely. Let it do its work, so that you become mature and well-developed, not deficient in any way. Wow, there's a challenge on your hands and in your face. I think that what I'm about to say might be even more challenging, so hold on to your seats for a second. You ready for this? I had to ask God twice if he really wanted me to say this today. And I got confirmation that, yes, I need to say it. Because what that scripture is effectively saying is if we still bow under pressure and we panic under stress, then we haven't yet developed the faith we require to handle the challenges we need. Ow, that's in your face. What God was saying to me was, listen, you prove your faith by the way you handle your challenges. I'm like, oh, great, thanks, Lord. Thanks for giving me that message to share. That's a challenge, isn't it? How do we handle our challenges? How do we handle the difficult times of life? How do we handle bad news? Depending on how we've been brought up, often we deal with it in different ways. Some will not panic. Some will over-panic. Sometimes we find it really hard to change throughout life and drop the way that we have become because it's so ingrained in us. I kind of came from a bit of a panicky family. So it's not difficult for me to panic. And I don't want to panic, but before I think about it, before my brain engages, my mouth opens. Some of you know exactly what I'm talking about. And if you're not thinking about it for yourself, you're thinking about it for someone else right now. No prodding or anything else, or staring at the person next to you right now. You know, we need to be ready for anything and everything, because anything and everything is going to come our way. And I find it very interesting that people give their lives to God and then think everything's going to be great. Everything's going to be easy. Everything's going to be easy street. Everything's going to be rosy in the gardens. Everything's going to be like tiptoeing through the tulips of life, and we're never going to have any challenges because, hey, we have God fighting for us. Yeah, but the fact that he's having to fight for us indicates there's going to be a fight. There's going to be something to fight for. Otherwise, there's no need to fight. If life is just one, you know, journey of tiptoeing through tulips, then you don't need someone fighting for you. But the fact that we're going to face challenges and we're going to have to deal with situations that are way beyond our control and way beyond the power that we have within us, we then need to operate within that power that's in every single one of us that, let me remind you again, is the same power that raised Jesus from the dead. It's living in you. Turn to your neighbor and say, you. You. That was supposed to be complimentary. In other words, what is Scripture really trying to teach us here? That there's still a maturity to come. That we are still maturing. That it will only come when our faith is tested. I want to say this, and I want you to hear me today, because I really think this is really vital that we get this. There is no other way on the planet to develop faith. It has to be tested by challenge. We can try and get out of it. We can try and avoid it. We can try and skate over it. But listen, the only way to develop faith is for it to be tested by challenge. So don't run from challenge. Face it head on. And the good news is that because he faced it, we can face ours with the same certainty and hope, because crosses don't last. What we go through on earth is basically making us the people that God wants us to be for heaven. They know that tough times come and tough times go, but tough people still remain. Where things have seemed to be hopeless and senseless to us maybe today, he can bring purpose and perspective. He can turn our why me into why not.
We hope you have enjoyed today's message. To download further resources, click on the resources icon. If this message has impacted your life, we would love to hear from you. So don't forget to join us next week for another inspiring message.